thank you very much for coming along again to look at ecological problems worldwide. In fact, today we're going to look at a particularly global issue, and one in which student and civilian activists from around the world have gathered and joined and drawn upon a tradition of civil disobedience and direct action that was brought to us largely in an exemplary fashion from the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa. It's gotten much larger than that, and in fact more universal in the sense that it's now global. We're going to want to look particularly at this problem of prisoners of conscience for the world as a whole, and how they've been acting on behalf of the citizens of the world around the world. I'm going to look at the actions of Greenpeace, a film called Black Ice, and the struggle to save the Earth. It's a pretty extraordinary story, led by a very extraordinary leader, who was brought to the attention of the American public largely through the interviews done with American media personalities like Bill Moyers. His name is Kumi Naidoo, and he came through the United States giving interviews about the kind of direct action that he's inspired and conducted and led for Greenpeace International. Let's take a look.
Welcome. We begin with drama on the high seas. Several days ago, environmental activists from Greenpeace International tried to climb a Russian oil platform in the Arctic. They were there to protest drilling for fossil fuels in this fragile ecology at the top of the world. But they were confronted by gun-carrying members of the Russian Coast Guard who fired warning shots dangerously close to the protesters and their inflatable boats. The next day, a Russian helicopter dropped armed troops onto the deck of the Arctic Sunrise. That's the Greenpeace command ship. She was seized and towed to the port of Murmansk, and the crew held for questioning and possible charges of piracy. Greenpeace has often dared to confront governments and corporations head-on, and this wasn't the first act of civil disobedience against the drilling rigs.
In fact, there had been, the year before this, an act of direct assault on a Greenpeace rig, and in fact it was led by Kumi Naidoo himself, although in the 2013 event he wasn't present. The year before, he very much was.
Here is their leader, Kumi Naidoo, climbing a platform off the coast of Greenland, braving rough seas and high-pressure fire hoses, deliberately pounding him and his boarding party with freezing water. For that action, Kumi Naidoo spent 4 days in jail, not the first time he's seen the inside of a prison cell. Born and raised in South Africa, by his teenage years, he was a vocal and prominent opponent of the racist policy of apartheid. He was incarcerated and beaten so often by the white regime that he finally had to escape to Britain, where he was awarded a Rhodes Scholarship to Oxford. With the end of apartheid, Kumi Naidoo went back home and became a prominent human rights activist. In 2009, he was named head of Greenpeace International, bringing his negotiating and advocacy skills to a worldwide organization of 3 million members. Welcome.
Thank you very much. It's good to be with you.
Okay. He was then interviewed for the rest of the hour, and I'd urge you to see the interview in full. You can find it on ecojustice.tv or transition-studies.tv. He's an extraordinary man and took part in this effort to bring the attention to what Russia was doing with these offshore oil platforms inside the Arctic Circle. Here's some of his own summary of the 2013 activity.
Отсюда нас из-за струи, из-за этого самого не видим, куда стрельнем. Или там на них как прямой строй, не знаю, помощнее.
Нет, это у нас все, что мы можем.
It was the first time I had taken part in a serious climbing activity, and the main challenge we faced was from the Gazprom management, who were instructing their staff to use heavy water cannons at those of us that were occupying the outside of the rig. The Russian Coast Guard were observing what we were doing, and even though the Gazprom management put huge pressure on them to intervene, they refused and observed.
Вот понятно, я, конечно, вы тоже обзорите. Просто вас призывают немножко встать в таком ракурсе, чтобы было видно, что вот ваши действия тоже мощные, решительные, целенаправленные. Сейчас вот поставили задачу снимок взять. Все, где-то в стороне стоите, цветы поливаете.
So when we went in 2013, we did expect things to perhaps heat up a bit more, but nobody anticipated the events that were to follow.
Okay. Now, that 2012 circumstance he did participate in, and you saw him sort of pulling himself up on the outside of the rig. So they anticipated something in returning in 2013, but Kumi was not among them. Instead, it was led by a group of 30 individuals who took this on as an amazingly well-coordinated and planned intrusion into this area of international waters over which Russia claims some authority. It's very interesting as a detail here. Take a look.
Northern Sea Route. Now, there's a demarcation line between the Kara Sea and the Barents Sea. Well, the Russian authorities still have jurisdiction in these waters, but because we're more than 12 miles off the coast, which puts us in international waters, we do have the right of innocent passage through these waters.
The Northern Sea Route is regarded by the Russian authorities as an area which requires special permission. We did apply for the permission, despite the fact that we fully comply. The Russian authorities proved not once that they don't want any independent eyewitnesses of what oil and gas companies are doing here on the Arctic shelf.
You breaking Russian Federation law concerning navigation by North Sea tracks of Russian Federation.
Right now the Arctic Sunrise is crossing into the Northern Sea Route. Despite Russian authorities' attempts to keep us out. We are going to expose and confront dangerous oil drilling in the Russian Arctic National Park. It seems the Russian authorities have something to hide, but we're going there to document and expose it.
You have to immediately stop your vessel and be ready to take my inspection.
Well, the Russian authority says you have to immediately stop what you're doing and take the inspection. Well, this became an interesting issue in itself. Unarmed Russian Coast Guard approaches the ship after some discussion with the captain of the ship. The captain insists that they can't come aboard with arms and they can't arrest anyone, but they're welcome to come aboard and discuss the issue. So they did.
Well, actually, we are in international water, so if you don't receive my permission, you cannot visit our ship. Over.
Refusal to obey. I will take measures right up to prevention fire. You understand me?
In a protest and in completely disagreement for your illegal act, you are not allowed to come in with guns. You are not allowed to arrest the ship. This is the condition for you to come on board. Over.
So, the Russian authorities were refused permission to come aboard if they had guns or if they were going to arrest anyone. But nevertheless, five or six of them came aboard without guns and without any intention to arrest. And then eventually left after some discussion with the Greenpeace activists and the captain of the ship. Now, it's a very interesting process because they leave without arresting anyone, and they leave without any gunshots, in a sense, being exchanged, because they realize, in effect, they're in international waters and may not have the authority to stop the Greenpeace group. But what happens is very interesting.
We have decided to leave the area. However, we do so only under threat of fire. We came here to expose dangerous preparations by the oil industry to drill in the Arctic. We have done that. We have also exposed the role of Russian authorities in protecting that industry. When you threaten us with force, you are acting to defend the oil industry. We are acting peacefully to defend the Arctic. Over.
We are acting peacefully to defend the Arctic. Over. That's the exchange from the Greenpeace people to the Russian authorities. Well, it gets resolved, as it were, the next day by the Russians landing by a helicopter on the back of the Greenpeace ship and arresting everyone present and then taking them off to jail. This has been documented in a film called Black Ice, which is now available for public viewing. You should get a copy. Take a look.
When they start oil drilling in the Arctic, it will affect the entire planet. Why on earth should we destroy all this just within, you know, 2, 3, 4 generations?
We believe that your platform and the activities being carried out in preparation for drilling for oil in the Arctic Ocean represents a real and immediate threat to the environment, both here and globally.
Zlomnia is the first Arctic offshore oil platform to go into production.
These very same companies that are promising to drill responsibly offshore are the same companies working onshore, and they have a horrible track record. It's impossible to respond to a major spill in the Arctic Ocean. It is truly a disaster waiting to happen. It's a question of when, where, and how bad it will be.
That's what makes it urgent for us to take action.
We came to the Arctic to protect the Arctic.
We go out there, bear witness, tell the world what's happening.
Climbing in protests can be dangerous, and I knew that the circumstances would be quite hard.
They had made a decision that was not going to happen.
This is Russian corporate ship. I suspect you in terrorism.
What you're actually doing is technically an act of war against Netherlands.
We just never had a clue they would try to charge us with piracy.
Anywhere short of, you know, North Korea, this will not stick.
This was a kind of show trial.
They wanted to punish us.
That they cannot lock up 30 peaceful people from 19 different countries for many years on an accusation as absurd as this.
Up's not an option. Turning the Arctic over to Gazprom is not an option. We have to tell them, stop. Enough is enough.
Okay, enough is enough. I mean, it's pretty dramatic here, and you should see it in the film called Black Ice. 30 activists take on the whole Russian state and are arrested and sent to prison. In fact, you can get access to some of the letters that they wrote.
A group of Greenpeace activists in custody in Russia is facing possible jail sentences of up to 15 years.
Their ship was seized 2 days after they attempted to board an offshore drilling platform owned by Gazprom.
Life has been quite difficult.
It's very cold now.
I'll stay strong.
Everyone sleeps with their clothes on.
I spend 23 hours a day in here.
The world is talking about Arctic oil. Dear James.
Dear supporters,
It's been over a month now that the special forces dropped by helicopter and took over our ship at gunpoint. What a terrifying moment, I must admit. Surreal, out of an action movie. Since then, life has been quite difficult.
We were towed into port under armed guard, Murmansk being the final destination.
When we were taken off the ship to be arrested, it felt like a scene from the Cold War. It was dark. I was scared.
The hardest moment was the first night in prison. Being shown to my cell and introduced to a couple of strangers was frightening, to say the least. The cell was about 8 meters long, 4 meters wide, and 6 meters high. I spent 23 hours a day in here, without nothing but the occasional book and my thoughts.
The weather has turned to winter.
Everyone sleeps with their clothes on.
I heard that from December, Murmansk is dark for 6 weeks. God, I hope I'm out by then.
There isn't a moment I don't think about my family.
I dream of the day I can run into their arms.
Existence here is incredibly bipolar, ranging from the fatalistic to blind panic that I will spend 15 years in a Russian prison cell for a crime I didn't commit.
I told my friend Phil that I was worried I couldn't cope. He told me I'd be fine. Always remember, there are a lot of people working very hard to release you.
Okay, well, that becomes the very important theme. How do they hear about the growing support that's emerging worldwide, largely because Kumi Naidu wasn't inside the group that was arrested, but was in fact outside and starting to organize on a global level solidarity in support of these prisoners of conscience within Russia. It's a pretty extraordinary story, and I'd urge you to listen to their letters and then see the whole film, the Black Ice film. You can learn a great deal about it through, and the Arctic 30 letters, through Transition Studies TV. What emerged was pretty extraordinary, because Kumi managed to in effect organize on the scale that he'd been capable of, both within South Africa and internationally in reference to development issues, and organize on a global scale with Greenpeace International to focus public attention on the issue.
My consuls came and visited me, and they just kept coming with these stories. And first it was 10,000 of people, then hundreds of thousands, then 2 million people that signed a petition calling for our release. And that was so touching and moving.
People were thanking us and saying that we are heroes and we have done so much for the climate and for the Arctic. We can avoid disastrous climate change and we can save the Arctic, because there are so many people around the world who care, and who care really a lot, and are ready to do many things, and just the feeling of this solidarity, it really gave me so much hope.
Tens of millions of people around the world who had never even thought about the Arctic before, who didn't know exactly where the Arctic was to start with, were beginning to say, why is this important? Why would these people take the risks that they did to draw our attention to what is happening? And at the end of the day, it's clear to us, it is that people power that showed the Russian authorities that they would have to tread carefully about how they actually treat the case of the Arctic 30.
That's really quite extraordinary. Let's hear it again, because in effect, Kumi gives voice to what he calls people power.
That they did to draw our attention to what is happening. And at the end of the day, it's clear to us, it is that people power that showed the Russian authorities that they would have to tread carefully about how they actually treat the case of the Arctic 30.
And that became the symbol, I am also one of the 30, the Arctic 30. I am also one of the 30. This is the sign that went around the world. Americans weren't terribly aware of the issue at the time. And it wasn't until Kumi drew it to our attention that it began to become part of the prisoners of conscience vocabulary and incidents. It's really quite an important movement that we're just beginning to catch up with. As executive director of Greenpeace International, he built the support for the movement from September 2013 onwards, and it was really quite eventually victorious. They were released. At the time, Kumi actually offered to submit himself in exchange for the 30. In other words, that the Russians could imprison him and deal with him as director of Greenpeace, symbolically, and sentence him to whatever they wanted to sentence him in exchange for the release of these 30 people. The Russians refused to consider that, and it wasn't until the response of this international people power movement that Kumi organized that they eventually saw the light. This is why the prisoners of conscience movement is crucial in reference to the climate issue. In effect, they didn't count on the tradition that Kumi had of working within the anti-apartheid movement and his emergence then as Greenpeace International's executive director. They thought they had a kind of safe Gazprom drilling rig in the north, but it was assaulted by these 30 Greenpeace activists who were willing to take on not only the roughing it in nature. You could see on their heavy fire hose conditions with freezing water raining down upon them to, in effect, force them into the water, and the use of live ammunition to scare them, as well as the Russian Coast Guard ship, which fired its cannons across the bow of the Greenpeace vessel. But then, as well as that kind of courage, direct action, there was the courage to face jail, and in fact, a stiff prison sentence, which was initially announced to be up to 15 years. Well, this group basically has become, in a sense, the prisoners of conscience for the world. Greenpeace, Black Ice, and the struggle to save the Earth is something we should focus on, because it's part of this transition studies effort. There's now a large movement towards transition studies. We're going to have to make a transition from the fossil fuel to the post-fossil fuel world. This is well known. This isn't it's not really a matter of discussion anymore. Everyone knows we have to get off of fossil fuels, if only because we're running out of them. The question is, how do we move gracefully through a transition period? And that's why transition studies are now becoming the focus of a lot of higher education. The transition really has to be several kinds. A transition toward a survivable future, not simply a tragic repeat of the syndromes of overshoot and collapse from the past. It has to be a transition that can absorb and adapt to abrupt changes in the ecosystem, including abrupt climate changes, not amplify and aggravate these things. There's been a urgent call gone forth from all faiths, all countries, all cultures, and all scientists. The message is simple.